I didn't prepare anything, but I recently asked this girl, and she said how I could motivate myself to practice. So I assume that the motivation problems comes from not feeling any progress, because we want something to play so badly, but we keep practicing and we don't feel any progress. I mean, okay, we do feel, but like it requires us to practice so much hours. Like, okay, if we need to prepare for the concert, we will probably practice 4 hours to make sure that it's going to be stable. So let's talk about how to make our practicing easily and efficiently. And that's why the topic would be how imagination and singing will help our piano technique. So let me explain what I mean. If you probably watch some masters playing piano, kissing, Arthur Rubinstein, some masters of past and present, you probably notice that they all use special technique when that allow them to play everything very fluently and so much expressively, and you can see they simply enjoy, they don't even think about technical problems, they simply just like go beyond music and just summon the beautiful musical realm, create something over there. So they do actually use some certain technique that unfortunately they cannot realize what is this, because they're simply born with this, you know, they're like genius, they do something but they cannot really explain how they do this. And at the same time, teachers, regular teachers, don't know this knowledge, so they don't teach this at school, because what they usually teach is how to press the key louder or softer, or play this faster or this slower. Basically it all comes to this, and if something is something troubles student, they will simply say, okay, go and practice more. So maybe if any of you had teacher before, they all knew this story. So what I'm trying to teach here is this technique that nobody actually can teach, and only masters knows, but again, they cannot teach because they actually cannot, they cannot explain how they do this. And this teaching is based on imagination and singing. So when we play, the most like common problem we have is that we would feel stiffness in hands that wouldn't allow us to play faster, to play freely, wouldn't allow us to feel basically comfortable while playing, to forget about technical any problems and just enjoy the music. And to start with, I should say that when we play, of course our body should be relaxed, but at the same time some parts of our body has to be tensed. And when I'm talking about tension, I'm talking about healthy tension, because there is a healthy tension and unhealthy tension. Unhealthy tension is this stiffness when everything is like dead and not moving and you cannot have control over it. And healthy tension, and when you're basically super relaxed and you feel freedom in your body, but at the same time you have flexible wrists, you have very cleaning and very, you know, smart fingertips that let you simply do like bass on the piano with absolutely relaxed hands, because when we usually play, there is nothing here and our hands will be just like this. So we have stiffness here, but so we cannot control anything using this way of playing. So how to achieve this? This is the problem. What usually teachers say, okay, relax your hands, make your wrist more flexible, you know, relax your wrist, you know, how to say, feel a little bit tension over here, don't play with your relaxed fingers, but that really doesn't work, because students have no idea about the sensations, because basically we're talking about sensations. So how to teach them, how to let them feel and acquire this master technique? We do this through imagination. When we imagine every note that is written in the score, like we would read the text, right? How we would read, we would see the word, we would hear it, right? Somehow in our mind, like, so, and we say that, all right? So first we need to hear exactly the sound that we want to produce on the instrument, and only then we should touch the piano. So the problem starts that when students play, or any pianists play, they really don't have any idea about sound imagination. Maybe they know, okay, this is the feeling. They have like general feeling, but that's not really exactly what will influence and affect your technique in a good way. So what I'm talking about is when you look at the score, you see the note, you have to imagine it, and you choose any timbres you can imagine. In beautiful vocal voice, for example, I love Anna Netrebko, her textural voice is beautiful. Or violins, or if we're talking about this octave, over here it could be beautiful cellos, and you simply see when we imagine this in beautiful violins, somehow this gives impulse over here, and this is how you start develop your fingertips. So all your body would be relaxed, but at the same time, this sensation of imagined sound would directly flow to your fingertip. And you would make this little bit, like this kind of movement with your fingertip, little bit. So maybe some of you can just volunteer, because it's always more fun when someone is here and when you can basically, not just in theory, but basically try it right away, along with some questions. Maybe some of you wanna come here and you just need to play one note. That's not scary at all.
Just to play one note.
I just... Yay! The bravest one. Thank you.
We have this note, so...
Sure.
Okay. Just one note?
Yes, okay.
Any note?
Any note. Well, okay, let's see. But, okay, before you try it, let's first try to imagine it. Can you, okay, you probably heard violins before, right? Orchestra music. So you can imagine like ocean of beautiful violins in like Tchaikovsky symphony, Rachmaninoff symphony, beautiful flowing. Okay, now you try to imagine this on a particular pitch over here. And all of you can try to do this. Now when you feel it, so you bring your absolutely sleepy hand to the keyboard, no tension, and you simply touch the key. All right, good. Now, so this technique, when you try to imagine every note and play it, and you don't allow yourself to touch the keyboard unless you actually have clear idea of sound imagination, that will gradually develop these fingertips and they will become cleaning and tenacious. So that will allow your hand to quick. Because usually students don't have it. It's absolutely dull here. That's why they cannot control the sound. Now another thing, if we talk about flexible wrist. Okay, we have so many different technique about like rotation technique, about like this one. All of you probably know this. So. But in all these techniques, one thing is always missing. They don't really connect, they are not really connected to the musical pattern. So what I mean is that any movement that we actually do in front of the piano have to be filled with our idea, what we want to hear, what we want to express on the piano. So if we talk about flexibility of wrist, how to achieve it? What I suggest is to try to imagine the same sound, violins, but try to imagine it with some kind of movement. Like for example, it's a very good example. If you imagine just a violinist playing, right? She would move her bow like this. So you can imagine how the sound would just go straight to the right, or to the left, or cello to say. So you can have this very clear idea of what I mean. So if I would sing, for example, I would sing to the right and then to the left, right? You will feel it. So what I'm asking you right now is to try to do the same. Can you just maybe try to sing? Okay, I didn't mention, you also will have to sing a little bit. Is it okay with you?
It's not just one note.
It's the same one note, but it's not just playing.
Like any note, actually. Which one is comfortable?
You mean to sing first and play, or?
If you could just sing and just feel how the movement goes straight to the right, like the river flows to the right, just imagine, and that would influence the way you sing. And you can even move your hand this way. That would be to the right.
I can't sing that high, by the way.
Sure. Okay, now try to feel a little bit different. Try to sing the same to the left. Alright, so everyone actually can do the same, and after some practice, you can feel it much better. And now, if you would play it, what would you sing the same way? And you would simply move your wrist gently, the same way, just like you sing. And this way, your wrist would express the way you sing. Okay, good. One more time. Your elbow. This is the thing. When you do this, your elbow should stay in the same place. Otherwise, your wrist is not really working, but your elbow starts working. Mm-hmm. Don't really affect wrist.
So, try to keep your. Okay. So you want the wrist to lead the elbow?
No. So far, I just want you to move the wrist. Now do the same to the left. No, I mean you can use the same hand. Mm. Yeah, yeah. But do this movement. Oh. Yeah, it's a little bit harder, but yes. Good. So this is the basic movement of wrist. Now, like I said, if you just make these movements, even if it's super efficient movements, like, okay, 100% everyone agrees, but if it's not filled inside with energy of your imagination, then inside this movement still will be dead. And this dead feeling caused this stiffness in our hands. So what I'm trying to say, now try to imagine again either violins that go this way or your own voice, and now use your wrist, not just play, but to express your ideas, to express your sound imagination.
Using just one note.
Yeah. So you imagine the note first, try to pre-hear it, pre-feel it. And then move your wrist as much as possible. Very big, don't be afraid to make big amplitude, because this is the way you imagine it. Big. In this case, when you play and when you imagine sounds with movement, then you will gradually develop good fingertip and good wrist movement. And the wrist will be flexible every time when you play. There will be no stiffness. And of course, that will benefit your technique. Because right now we talk about one sound, all right. But if we talk about playing scales or arpeggios, so we know that one of the first reason why we feel stiffness is our wrist. Our wrist becomes stiff, and then everything becomes stiff. So now, if we just mention the elbow here, let's talk about elbow. So where do we actually use elbow? We use elbow when we change positions. Probably all of you know what position is. Everyone taught sight reading, if you're piano teachers, we know we start in one position, first to grades, now grade three, we go to different positions, right? So every time we're gonna change position, we're gonna use our elbow to prepare it. And actually, if you ever heard these interviews of these awesome masters, they would also say, imagine here violins, imagine here cellos, and this is like beautiful voices singing. They're not saying this because it's, you know, they're saying this because this is exactly how they feel while playing. They just try to explain what they feel. So all of them know this technique. I'm sure everyone imagined every note. So when we talk about elbow, for example, we're gonna play, let's say, arpeggios, right? So in arpeggios, it's very clear we have one position here, another position here, another position here, right? So how usually everyone is playing, as soon as they press first finger, they would do something like this, twist their wrist and elbow, something like this. So how are you supposed to speed up the tempo, you know? That's why we need our elbow. So, for example, here, if we play, we would, every time we finish our first, our current position, we would move elbow first, and then elbow would lead the hand. So elbow should always lead the hand. I mean, you know, I was taught professionally, but I was told about this only when I was like 15 years old or 20, when I started playing when I was 5. So that's quite an issue, you know. So anyways, move first elbow, then your hand is following. When you go down the same way, first you move elbow. So one of the most interesting thing is when you try to understand which note is actually has movement to the right or which note has movement to the left, you don't have to invent anything. You just need to look at the score deeper, with deeper understanding. So the rule is very easy. I will show you on the scale example. If the note that we play is basically higher than the previous note, then this note will be to the right. So because in the scale, every single note is higher than previous one when they go up. That's why we have to keep our wrist this way. When we go down, every single note is lower than previous one. That's why we go this way. And the same way in arpeggios, that's why you cannot do like this. Up and then shake down. So it's the essence. And even if you look at the shape of the any melodies in the score, of anything, like for example, it also have the shape, so left, right, because G is higher, so it's right, left, right. So that will help you start have this, you know, singing attitude while playing. So to summarize the first part, I just want to tell you that in order to have fluent technique and spend to learn the piece, not months, but just a week, trust me, like I used to spend months, but since I discovered this, I spent like literally 5-7 days to learn any piece. Because I really enjoy, because every single hour I make huge progress, and that's why I'm always motivated. So, in order to have this good technique that allows you to play as you always wanted, you have to have clear idea of every note that you play first in your mind, and that will help you develop your fingertips. You have to have clear idea of the pattern of the notes, which one is higher, which one is lower, and hence to have this direction in your imagination of the sound. That will affect the flexibility in your wrist. And you know, you need to know exactly where to work with your elbow, because elbow can simply prevent us from having good technique. Like I just showed in arpeggios or scales, if elbow really doesn't know, you really don't know what to do with your elbow.